remember that time when... Actually, no, I don't. Hey!
Hello.
So... You've got a lot to explain in an elevator ride. Are you feeling prepared? Are you feeling scared?
I'm not afraid of you.
Maybe you should be, because I'm your limitation. I'm the one that you have to explain everything to.
No, I am not scared.
All right, let's get started. So, what is memory?
Well, when we think about the brain actually is consisting of many individual cells that I think of like little train stations.
Okay.
So all these train stations are connected to each other by tracks, right?
Yes.
So that's the brain cells connecting to other brain cells by synapses. So the tracks are like synapses.
And what is the train?
So the train is like an electrical signal.
Okay.
Like the neurons like bing, 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 bing.
Yeah.
So when we form a memory, we take something from our environment and we put it in one of the stations.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you recall that memory when you use that information again.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, if you have a really strong memory,
yeah,
then that means the connections between two stations are really strong.
Would smarter people have more of those?
So what is thought to happen is that some people have more, like, stronger connections between many, many stations. And this enables them to, like, remember things really quickly.
Yeah.
And if we stop using those connections, they get weaker again.
So how is a memory actually stored? Like, what physically is it?
Yeah, so there are a lot of theories about that. So what we think is there must be some sort of physical change in the neuron. So, like, you know, something is happening in this train station. Because we know that worms can remember, they're very quite simple animals. Humans can remember. So something must be fundamentally changing in these neurons. So that's the brain cells, which is not that difficult.
Right.
Yeah, so worms don't have action potentials. They don't have myelin, which insulates the signal from being lost, but they can still learn. So, which implies that something in the stations are fundamentally similar to humans or other mammals.
We're at the halfway point.
Oh no.
Do you reckon you're halfway through explaining everything that you want to tell me?
I think so.
Yes, okay, good. Let's go.
So if they are stored as some kind of biochemical or molecular change, then if we figure out what those changes are, we can just kind of put them back into the brains of people who, you know, have memory problems or, you know, neurodegeneration.
So theoretically, if we could find the physical thing that forms a memory, we could take it out and transplant it.
In theory,
maybe.
Yes, but we're very, very far away from doing that.
Well, So how good is the live imaging that we have of brains?
It is good, but the resolution is not fantastic. We don't look at, like, you know, individual brain cells. So that's why we use animal models. So
yeah.
I use the worm because they are transparent. I can look at each of their brain cells individually. It's pretty
really?
Cool, pretty hectic. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool, man.
So we can figure out what those, you know, physical changes are in the worm and try and translate that to a human. So we take a complex problem and we answer it in a simple system.
Well, thank you for teaching me about memory.
My pleasure. Bye-bye. Come back soon.
Bye. So if I remember correctly, the brain is made up of cells called neurons, and these are connected via synapses, and messages are sent between them through electrical signals. And these messages are often memories, which are stored within the neurons. Now, what they actually are physically, we don't quite know yet. But if we did know, we would have a much better grasp on controlling memory. The problem in this kind of study is that you actually need a living subject, because you need to be able to look at whether it remembers something before and after you manipulate it. So that's why we look at things like transparent worms, where we can actually look at their brains while they're still alive. Thank you, nature, for creating transparent worms. And then scale that kind of information up to humans. And I am so excited about this kind of study, because we've seen how impactful diseases like Alzheimer's or dementia can be, because really our memories are so much of what make us us, right? Now here's a memory test for you. Do you remember our video on string theory? Well, if not, here it is right there. You can watch it again and strengthen all those connections in your brain so you remember forever. 2 for 1.